back for episode 2. This your boy DJ Boz.
DJ Rickey D.
And this is the sports show about nothing. Introduce our guest, Rick.
Man, we got special guests here today. We got Mr. Destin Challenger, local.
Yes, oh, sir.
Spring Park product, UAB product. And we also got Mr. Otis Leverette here.
That UAB. Tell them where they know Otis from, though. Tell them where they know him from.
They know Otis from the league, man.
Yeah, man.
He's one of only 12 people that's been drafted by UAB, man, which has started in 1991. And actually, he was the fourth person ever drafted by UAB.
Five.
Yes.
Yeah.
How y'all doing today, man?
Oh, man, I'm doing great. I'm just waiting to get rolling. Everybody telling me about the fun y'all have on the show. Let's get this thing going.
Let's go, man. What y'all been up to these days, man?
What y'all got going on, man?
I'll let Destin take that question.
Okay. Recently, I started my own company, man, Next Gen. It's a company where high school kids can send in their film, and I'll send it back out with things they need to work on, things they can improve on to take the game to the next level so they can get to the collegiate level. And ultimately, I know all guys want to get to the NFL level. So growing up under this guy, I feel like I've seen great people. You know what I'm saying? I worked out with Jameis Winston. I worked out with Amir Abdullah. So I've seen what it takes to get there. And that's one thing that I can't thank him enough for, you know what I'm saying, for teaching me what it takes to, you know what I'm saying, get to that next level. And the hard work, and now I'm just trying to give it back out, you know. So it's been growing. It's been going real well, man.
Okay,
so
plug your website. What's your website?
Oh, yeah.
Shout out to Modern Day Fitness.
Oh, yeah. Shout out to MDF, too, man. Thechallenger.co. It's thechallenger.co, man. So check it out.
And we'll put it up for you guys on YouTube once we get everything edited up and stuff.
Well, as for me, man, I got about 3-4, I guess my life is compartmentalized, a whole lot of things. First and foremost, my biggest responsibility, of course, being a father, being a husband, so just enjoying the family thing, and then professionally what I have going on, just training athletes all through the Southeast. I mean, Birmingham is primarily my base. It's the bulk of the athletes that I train, but I have athletes come from Atlanta, Memphis, some come up out of Florida. I mean, I run a full-scale training program, and, you know, what I like to, I guess, pride myself on, I guess my mantra is I take a holistic approach with all the athletes I get. A lot of times, man, we spend so much time on footwork and cone drills and skill work that we forget about at the end of the day. Most guys make ESPN news not because of how great they playing football, it's because of the stuff they can't deal with and cope with off the field.
Right, right.
So that's why I take such a holistic approach on these kids and dealing with them with their life. Because, man, you know, you can get up there, I can help you get down to a 4-2-40, man, but at the end of the day, you know, once you get there, if you ain't got some other things taken care of, it's going to nullify all that speed on the field with the things you do off the field.
Right.
So I'm real big on trying to just deal with these kids' life. And, and also, too, man, when I'm dealing with the young brothers out here, I'm always trying to teach them how to do things right. And so it's an undertaking, but it's definitely, I definitely feel like I'm living out my purpose. And the name of my company is, of course, Modern Day Fitness.
Okay.
And been in business now about 7 years. And man, we've had way over 100 athletes sign full scholarships out of the program. And that's male and female, because, you know, some people like to think just because I was a football guy, that I only do football players, but man, I've trained female soccer players, female basketball players, boxers. I mean, I've kind of had my hands in athletics as a whole. And so the real truth of the matter is I'm an athlete person way more than I'm just a football person. But ultimately, I'm just using athletics, man, to be able to speak to the insides of these kids, man.
Right.
So that's kind of what we got going on right now.
Okay. All right.
What's the age when you start off at age of training the kids?
Well, primarily, I to be honest with you, I kind of like to start them around 12 years old. What I do is probably too rigorous for young kids. It's not about the athletic level per se, or the athletic prowess of a kid. It's about the attention span. Because what I've learned at the end of the day, I got enough in my brain to teach. The problem is can a kid, you know, focus long enough to apply? And so application is everything. So to just to keep parents from sending to me, and you know, oftentimes in life we find out, man, the same people that can take us from A to H can't take us from H to Z. So I consider myself a H to Z guy. You know, there are other people calling to deal with younger kids, but my target age is preteen all the way up into, you know, adulthood. So that's primarily the guys I deal with, because that's probably, you know, more my market.
Okay. Destin, I got this question for you, man. How was the transition from a student athlete to just being a regular student?
It's tough. One thing you gotta do, man, you gotta find value in yourself off the field. You feel what I'm saying? So when you're a football, college football player, you don't have nobody coming up to you saying, hey, you did a great job on the communication test. You know what I'm saying? You did a good job on this. You can have, hey, you made 10 tackles last week. Good job on the field. So once that leaves, you like, dang, like where's my value almost? You're like, because that's all you know almost. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So the big thing I would tell any guy who has to stop playing or their career is cut short is you gotta know that you have value in yourself more than off the field, because you can't get caught up in this is all I can do. You know what I'm saying? Even though it's gonna be hard, because that's what everybody's kind of telling you. You know, you good football player. That's all you hear. You know, so of course that's what you're gonna think. But yeah, I feel like that's the toughest part. And once you get over that hump, and you know, okay, football ain't everything. Like I can do other stuff. That's when you can make your transition and go on to do other big things.
Did you say Otis helped with that transition?
Oh my God, yes. Because the thing that most people don't realize about his company is, if you're not mentally strong, you can't make it through those workouts. You can't make it through the workout. Yeah, you see the workouts, Rickey. So if you're not mentally strong, you can't make it through. So from what, eighth grade I started going to India? Eighth grade on to sophomore year in college. I got very mentally strong, which I feel like that might have been the whole purpose of that, just so I can make it through this, you know? So that helped me out tremendously, because it helped me get through that transition too. Because I knew, okay, I've been with Otis for years. Like, yeah. I know, hey, I got to make something. This ain't the end, you know. I got to get something else going, you know. So, yeah, he helped me tremendously. My God.
In your experience, Otis, when transitioning from the league, because you say that kind of helped him by you already experiencing that mm-hmm. earlier.
Well, you know, I always, when I deal with athletes, I take a Mr. Miyagi approach. It's, I teach you to wax on and wax off, but I always know there's going to be a bigger game than the Super Bowl coming. Mm-hmm. So in essence, you know, I train from the end and not from the beginning. Most people deal with athletes on what they see that day. I look at them, I'm looking 3, 4, 5, 6 years ahead of them, because I realize a lot of these steps, and I couldn't understand when I was, you know, his age or even younger, why God allowed me to experience so much. But it's almost like every athlete that he sent me, I've been able to almost live a portion of their lives, you know. And with Destin transition, I'm just going back to that a little bit. With his being so abrupt, you know, and the segue into the way I left the NFL, it was the same way. It was abrupt. It was like one day you hear, I just signed a contract for a little over $3 million, 2-year deal. You know, everything, I'm flying high. I'm finally getting my shot. It wasn't the big money, but I was getting a shot at you know, a long way from South Georgia, using the bathroom in the outhouse. You know, so I was excited, you know, about that. But then just as that happened in a flash, I was diagnosed with something called hypothyroidism. So it put it where I couldn't, it speeds up the metabolism and the heart rate, and it put it where I couldn't no longer pass the physical. So just that quick, man, after signing a contract, when 3 weeks later, they, you know, they bring me and tell me bad news. Hey, man, you know, we love you, but you won't be able to, because of your resting heart rate, you won't be able to pass a physical. So when that happened, I had to make that transition. So it was amazing the way his career ended. So I had already kind of been there. But in the same sense, all of them from the beginning, when I got them, I was teaching them to transition out, because I just don't think you can go make that transition abruptly. And to be very honest, man, athletes are the most exploited human beings on the planet Earth. You know, a lot of people try to act as if that we're getting this spoiled treatment and all these great things are happening. Yeah, it may seem like that on the other, on one end, but man, I would just say, man, there are many people in society that has to deal with the grand drop that an athlete has to take the day that he leaves the game. And so that's why self-evaluation and self-assessment and self-education is so important. And you can't start that process the day you leave, because I'm going to be honest with you, man, you set yourself up for a long period of depression. So in saying that, you know, for me, again, I went through some of the same similar things, man, trying to find that self-worth, being dropped from the game very abruptly, and just trying to figure out, hey, man, where do I go? Am I just a defensive end? And having to really just deal with that whole concept of you're not this character you created, you know, 20 years ago anymore. You know, and then have to come out of that. Cam talk about that superhero, and I can identify with that whole concept, man. Superman having to throw in that cape and turn in the phone booth all on the same day. It's a rough situation. So and then no one's there to help you deal with it, because they've been told falsely by some of these media outlets that you're living this overly privileged life. So in essence, they feel as if, oh, well, you know, they almost get a mind frame like, oh, good for you. Now you can live like the rest of us. So, like I say, man, it's a very, very complex deal. But I think the way you prepare for it is you almost got to start teaching a kid to transition out of sports the day that they get in sports. Yeah. It goes with the training. I mean, already with my kids right now who are young athletes, I'm already teaching them how to transition out. But at the same time, I'm transitioning them in. It's a crazy deal, man. It really is.
How do y'all feel about how the media is chastising Cam right now?
Picture this. All four of us sitting in the barbershop. Say what you say in the barbershop.
Cleanly.
Okay. Like, I think it's great. I think not what they're doing to him. I think what he's doing, standing up for himself and being himself, is great. Because I think it's big for young African-American kids to see when you make it big, you don't necessarily have to feel bad about your culture. You know what I'm saying? He danced, he do all the stuff that's in his culture. Like, this is how he grew up. These are the people he grew up around. This is the music he listened to when he grew up. This is the dances that his friends are doing, you know? So he shouldn't feel bad about doing the things that are prevalent in his culture. You feel what I'm saying? Culture, yeah, right. Hip-hop culture. And he shouldn't have to apologize.
So you, how can I put this? So you basically agree with Ryan Clark. Ryan Clark said he believes that it's more of a cultural thing than it is a race thing. I kind of think they go twofold.
I think they go hand in hand. I think they go ahead, because I think if it was a white quarterback doing that, I don't think it would be a huge problem.
But you know, the boy up in Green Bay, he come out there pelvic
thrusting. Yeah, I'm talking about all this, you know, so, Tom Brady, he spiked the ball, and nobody says anything about that.
It's cool when they do it.
Exactly. So
I agree with Ryan Clark, and I agree with your position on it as well. How you feel about it, Ola?
Man, it's pretty complex. I think what's going on is probably a lot older than Cam. I think in order to really speak on this particular issue, I think you gotta go deeper than just football. I think what happens is a lot of time, man, we feel we can't understand.
Most definitely true.
And what we try to do, man, we all as human beings, we try to box things up. We all running a UPS company, right? and we want to box it up and package it to where we can understand it. Not only that, we want to make sure our truck is sufficient enough to carry the boxes in which we package up.
Right.
So what happens is man, we package these boxes up, and we want to put people in them simply because, and a lot of times what I found out is, a lot of times, it's not just a race or even a cultural thing. It really is. I just want to reduce it down to a point in which I understand it.
Right.
And I think when you got a guy like Cam who's unapologetic about it, and he's really not giving out an instruction manual, and flat out tells you, hey, look, I'm not making any apologies for who I am, and I'm not going to go over it 1,000 times, and I'm not going to clothe your ego to make you feel good about what I'm doing and accept what I'm doing. I think when you have that whole mind frame, that always going to throw a bunch of people off their bases and make a lot of folks get defensive. And again, man, it's all an attempt to understand. And what's sad is, man, in America, I think one of the saddest things that we do, man, we just refuse sometimes to communicate, man. Mm-hmm. We like to deal with this is a clone society, man. And if you aren't willing to clone or be cloned, then people tend to have issues with you when you don't feel a clone, man. Right. And I think there's an image out there for a quarterback with heavy quotations around it.
Right.
And I don't think he fits that image. I think if he was a defensive tackle, we wouldn't even be having this conversation. But I think there were a group of people that got together and came up with a guideline and a prototypical version of what a quarterback should be. And I think those people are probably more angry than anybody else, and I think those are the people that run that particular UPS company that's boxing, trying to box Cam up.
Because you had Russell Wilson the last 2 years go to the Super Bowl, and nobody even talk about it.
Yeah,
and it's crazy that Cam is catching all this flack this year about it. It's crazy. I don't understand it.
But last year, Rick, you and I had an episode of the show where we talked about the prototypical quarterback.
Yeah,
and everything that we elaborated on, then Otis just stated.
Yeah,
so. That just let you know it's more like-minded individuals mm-hmm. out here that reads and sees the pictures on the wall. So,
mm-hmm. okay. yeah. I mean, even in saying that too, man, it really is. It's just, man, it's a heck of a box job. That's all I can tell you. That's why, again, I go back to what I spoke on earlier. Man, I just think we all got to search for some form of enlightenment, man, and find the beauty. And everybody having a different opinion. And that's the hardest thing to do in life, man, because we all been kind of taught to find a bunch of people that believe kind of, you know, like we believe in. And I just, you know, I just think that's so unfair. It's really almost unfair to God. Because it really, you know, what we really try to do, we try to simplify his creation.
Right.
And it really is a very, very complex creation. And I think it becomes the ugly show. I really do. So. But yeah, I mean, I think we do have some like-mindedness there, and again, man, I'm rooting for Cam, and just as I was rooting for, you know, Russell Wilson, Peyton Manning, all of them, man. I'm in the fraternity, so I just have a natural respect for the order, the fraternity, and the guys that were able to manifest a dream that you started 7, 8 years old and actually allowed to come true, man, and the odds you have to overcome to get there. So I respect the fraternity. When I watch NFL football, I watch it more in all of the fraternity part of it, more than I look at the teams and the point spreads and all that other crap. I'm really unmoved by all of that.
Right. So real quick, I got a question for you, Otis. When did you know you could play in the league? Did that light go off in high school, or did it go off while you were here at UAB, or when did it really hit? Like, man, I could do this.
I just always kind of, you know, as I got older, I kind of pride myself on being abnormal. I'd be lying to you if I just said, man, hey, man, the NFL is going to be my abnormal feat. You know, one of them, I should say.
Right.
It kind of came to me as time went on. Heck, when I was a young boy, man, I was Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I was last guy picked. You know, yeah. I mean, I was a short, fat kid up until 8th grade, 9th grade, summer. You know, I'm 5'7", short, fat kid, and grew to like 6'3", in one summer, you know. Mm-hmm. So I can't say athletics was... Well, don't get me wrong, I've always been an athlete and always believed in the whole athletic process.
Right.
But I can't say I was one of these lifers that said, man, oh, from day one, ever since I was a little kid, I had a ball in the crib. You know, like
right,
James
right.
was one of those lifers. Right. You know, James Winston's a kid I trained, and I think he was one of those lifers. But, I can't say that, man. But the time I started to really realize, man, that I could do something special was right 12th. Going, you know, my 12th grade year, getting ready to go into junior college,
mm-hmm.
and it was around that time when I started to realize, because I had a pretty rough childhood as far as academically, behavior wise, I was always kid got in trouble in school. I was always the kid that had marginal grades, but it was so crazy as I got older, 11th, 12th grade year, I started to realize, like, wow. You know, a lot of these cats that were always the good kids when we was in school and the ones making straight A's, man, you know, they smoking marijuana now, they got, you know, they got babies, they got all kind of stuff going on. And I started to realize, man, you know, I'm starting to peak. Like, I'm starting to get it, and they starting to revert back. Right. You see what I'm saying? So so it's kind of crazy to watch, like, you know, the guy that I guarantee at 13, everybody would say, oh, he'll end up doing life in jail. It's the same guy. Now I'm reaching back, talking to some of my peers who were the quote-unquote, they were the guys that took the names when the teacher walked out of class, when we, you know, good kids. And then I'm talking to them like, bro, you know, you don't need to be smoking, man. You don't need to be drinking. I'm on something else then, because it's like I done been there and done that, man. So it was kind of like, it was kind of funny, but it was around that time I started to realize, man, you know, I'm a hyper-focus, man. I'm going to put all my eggs in this basket, man, and see what happened. Because I knew the one thing I knew, I had to do something because I wasn't returning back empty-handed, null and void to that hometown I came from. 15,000 people growing up hard like I did. I was just like, man, I'm not. When I got that scholarship to junior college, like, I'm not returning empty-handed. And so, and football, my vehicle, then we finna put, you know, full coverage on it, and we finna drive the wheels off of, you know. So that was kind of... you know, that point when that thing clicked in. But you know, I think that's why I'm so big on it. It's all about when you're peaking.
Right.
I tell kids it's like the Olympic race, man. You win all the races going up to it. But, man, if you ain't ready when that gun go off in the Olympics, good luck. You ain't going to win gold. Right. So it's all about, and that's why, you know, a lot of people, they get so caught up in good kids and bad kids. I just think they're kids. You know, it just, some of them have more glaring problems than others. But I don't really believe in the whole concept of good kid, bad kid, because it's all about where this kid going to be when it's really time to peak, when it's time to shift from man, from boyhood to manhood, or woman, girlhood from, to womanhood, you know. So that's kind of my synopsis on it, man.
Destin, for you, man, I was seeing where four of y'all came out the year that you came to UAB.
Yeah.
One went to Rice, one went to
Arkansas State. And the other two.
Yeah, came here.
Came here.
Are y'all still, besides you, the rest of them playing ball?
Yeah, Chris Humes, he's at Arkansas State. He's playing, I think he's playing safety now. He's a big dude, man. But he playing safety. I heard he's doing well. And Justin Carter's at Rice.
Yeah.
I ain't heard much from Justin, man. He's like a ghost, man. He went to Texas and kind of
did
it. But, I think he's still playing. Don't quote me on it, though. But that was a cool process, man. You know, being lucky enough to be around people who have the same interest as you, you know, and wanting to get to the next level as well. So that was definitely an interesting process, and I was fortunate enough to have one of my teammates come to UAB with me. So it was a fun process, man. Spain Park, shout out to Spain Park.
Man, we got a great show going on right now. We got to pay some bills real quick. We'll be right back after this, man. This is DJ Boz.
DJ Rickey D.
This is a sports show about nothing.
That's pretty good, man. All right, we back. Boy, this is Sports Show About Nothing. Got DJ Boz.
DJ Rickey D.
We back, man. Go ahead and ask him the question.
For y'all just not tuning in, we got two special guests here today, two UAB greats. We got Destin Challenger and we got Otis Leverett. Question. Tampa Bay, man, we already have what? It's like three black coaches that we have in the NFL?
Correct.
Lewis. Hugh Jackson just got Tumlin, and actually four Detroit Lions with Caldwell. The fifth coach would have been Lovey. How they did Lovey down there, man? My opinion, I feel like they did him totally wrong because Dirk Cutter hasn't proven anything for my eyes. He was a former coach of Arizona State. They let him go, so he came and was an offensive coordinator, and he's just not getting his shot. I don't see how you can fire somebody to hire somebody that hasn't proven anything. And Lovey has proved something.
I think it was way bigger than James, baby. It was bigger than Nino Brown. It was bigger than Nino Brown.
It always is.
So how do you all feel about the lack of diversity? We'll call it diversity for the show's sake. The lack of diversity as far as coaching in the league.
Well, I mean, I guess the first thing I like to kind of attack, like, because I do have a little bit of insight on the whole Tampa Bay situation, I think, you know, sometimes our greatest strength is our greatest weakness, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. Lovey is always known for being a real, real loyal person, a stand-up man, a man of integrity, and sometimes, man, When you're playing it with gangsters, it's kind of hard to be Gandhi.
Right.
I mean, you know, I'm just being honest. I mean, if I'm going to a gunfight, I'm probably not going to make it out of there if I'm throwing rocks. So I think what happens is Lovey's the type of guy that, again, man, a very loyal guy. And from my understanding and from my information down in Tampa, the big deal was with Lovey is that the ownership was willing to keep Lovey. The problem was Lovey, they wanted Lovey to fire his whole defensive staff. And when that whole thing arrived, Lovey just like, hey, man, you know, I know his son was one of the DB coaches, and Leslie Frazier, who was a longtime friend of his, was the coordinator. And I guess Lovey just say, hey, man, if the plane ain't going to go down, we're going to crash together. Right. And I think the ownership just kind of, at that point, that gave them. Now that's not to say that there were no pre-plans, because sometimes – you know, I can come up with a plan, and I can kind of almost know how you're going to react to it because I know what type of person you are. I'm not giving the ownership an out saying that maybe, you know, it was all Lovey's fault because, again, they, you know, when you're around people long enough and you can study them and you kind of know, hey, if I come to Lovey with this, this will clear me, this will emancipate me to the media, and I know Lovey well enough to know he's not going to fire these guys so we can make it look like it's an all Lovey deal. But from my understanding, from the information that I've received, was that Lovey was asked to fire some of his assistants. And everybody who knows who Lovey is, the very thing that makes him and has raised him to the level he is, his integrity, his loyalty and things of that nature, this is the very thing, man, that got him out of there. And that's kind of the information that I received. Now, for me, you know, I would have an issue if I was in Tampa personally, because I just think it's an issue whether it's a diversity issue or not. If it was two white guys, for me, it would bother me to know that a guy on the staff has taken the head coaching job and the guy that hired you is fired, and then they elevated you to head coach. I would, you know, it's something about that to me, man, sound real, you know, below board, you know. And so for me, as a player, I would always kind of have my eyebrows raised about the whole situation. Even more than the diversity issue, man, there's something that expands to me way beyond even diversity or race or anything, man. And for a guy to bring you in and for you to lack loyalty, me personally, love you, bring me in. If I'm Dirk Cutter, you couldn't have gave me that job. I don't care how much money you gave me. It's just certain things, man, that I want to leave here with. You know, when I want to fix it when they have my funeral, bro, they ain't got to lie. Right. You know, I mean, and so in essence, I don't think I could have did it. But again, that's, you know, that's kind of the way maybe Cutter operates. But I couldn't have did it.
Right.
It's the same thing with Caldwell. You see how Detroit now has been talking about they end up keeping him, but it was the same way. It was like, we gotta get rid of Detroit. So Caldwell ended up clearing staff. He got rid of the offensive coordinator. Got rid of a couple guys on the staff before they ended up making the decision to keep him. Yeah. And it's amazing that they. How we only, the opportunities that we get, like Hugh Jackson was saying in the interview, that if you're not a defensive coordinator, it's hard for offensive guys that are black to get an opportunity. Because usually, if you're black, like Eric Bennett with Green Bay, you're going to already have a coach that's in front of you that's have a name. So it's like they looked on them, looking at them to already be running the offense. McCarthy is running the offense, not Eric Bennett. Mm-hmm. But they don't give us them shots like that. It's crazy, man.
I definitely think you got a point there. I mean, to be totally honest, the whole dynamic of the NFL and the way it's structured as opposed to the NBA is always been kind of funny to me. The way that in football you have to go through these long drawn out processes to prove that you're a coach.
Right.
You know, from assistant to from equipment manager to grad assistant to, to GA to coach. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's such a long process. Whereas the adjacent kid can walk straight off of a basketball floor and become a head coach of an NBA team. It just, to me, I definitely think there's something there with that whole thinking and that mind frame. And hey, I think that speaks to the diversity as well as process.
Right.
I think the process of becoming a coach, because right now, you know, I have over 30 years of real-time experience with football, and I probably couldn't walk in the average college coach office in the country and immediately assume a position job unless it was somebody who really, really knew me and really, really believed in me. But off resume alone, they probably wouldn't give me a shot. And in my opinion, I think that speaks to the process is really skewed, man, considering that Jason Kidd can walk straight off of a basketball floor and become a head coach.
Yeah. Being that you deal with kids and you catch them, like you say, from that H to Z level, have you thought about going into coaching?
No, I think coaching would limit me, because I think I do my best work outside of the system.
Okay.
I think once I get involved with the system, I think at that point, then I got to play by the system rules. And there are things that the system will not allow me to do. And when I talk about the system of football, man, you know, I always believe you can fight the power, but it's rough to beat the system.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And so what I do to combat all of that, where I don't have all these stipulations on the hours I can spend with a kid, the things I can say, the influence that I can have on them,
right.
I just like to I like to keep that freedom, because I, you know, within that, you know, again, man, it's hard to teach somebody how to get out of prison when you're there with them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just the truth.
What about you, Destin? You want to go in the coach? I know you was over there. We talked a while back. You was at Sanford.
And I don't know. I guess I don't know if it's because I grew up under him or what, but I'm kind of getting the same type of feelings, you know, being in the system, or being with him and then going into the system almost. It's kind of like, you can't fully be yourself. You can't fully do what you want to do almost. And I'm so used to seeing that with him. So it's kind of like, I'd rather just, you know, do it the other way kind of.
Yeah.
You know, find my own way to do it. You know, make my own lane to right. get to where I want to go almost. You know, so I got the Cam Newton approach. I'm
right.
Like, I'm going to do me. You know, I ain't really worrying about who like it or anything like that. So.
And you now you were on campus when the scandal went down with mm-hmm. Them dismantling football along with archery and bowling.
Mm-hmm.
Give us your take on
free archery.
Right.
Free bowling, all that. Yeah,
free bowling, man.
I hope they build a bowling alley in this new facility. Give everybody, man. Give them free. Go ahead, man.
I think the toughest thing about that whole situation is to this day, we still don't really have an explanation. You feel what I'm saying? Like, I still don't really know why everything happened. It's all still stipulation. It was this kind of money. If it wasn't this, it wasn't that, the number wasn't right. But we still don't have, like, this is why, really. Because we all know it's deeper than that, you know. But to this day,
bigger than Nino Brown.
Everything is bigger than Nino Brown. So to this day, man, we still don't have, like, somebody that really came, okay, this is why it happened. You know, this is why this happened. This is why they shut this down. This is why bowling, rifling, all that. So I think that's the toughest part about it. But it was a crazy deal, man. To see all them just grown men just bust out crying, you know, like that. Yeah, that's a tough moment, man. That's rough. Yeah, that's rough. Like he said, man, athletes, we one of the most exploited human beings on the earth. No question. No question about it.
I'm quite sure I know the answer, but you feel like y'all should be getting paid?
Student, man, I never was down financially, personally, you know, because I wouldn't. I think a lot of the people that say that, man, we ain't got no money because you're trying to be grown before your time. You're in the club every weekend. You know, you got other habits that cost money. You got a whole bunch of other stuff going on. So a lot of times, what I found out is it ain't quite as bad as some people would make it. But let me say this: I don't believe in the standard every month getting money. What I believe in is some type of money that could be retroed from the day that you graduate. Maybe a lump sum that we're given at a certain amount of time after you learn how to conduct yourself and manage money, man. You know, some almost like a farewell gift to say, hey, go start your life. Because he always remember while all your buddies were doing internships and working on jobs and getting real life experience, everything you did was out on the football field. And it took me to get out of the NFL to go apply for a job because, you know, I got a degree. Oh, well, I got a degree. I'm going to put me on the nicest suit and go plop my resume down on someone's desk. Well, when I got there, I figured out all you've been doing is playing football. And even though you have a degree, your degree is null and void compared to this person that actually, while you out on that football field, doing internships, networking, going to all type of conventions and all these other things that you were just, quite frankly, unable to do. And so, really, to me, that's the biggest snuff you get as a player, that you don't get a chance to start marketing yourself to form, you know, future employers, that you don't get a chance to start marketing yourself to business opportunities and things of that nature, because of football athletics alone takes up so much time. So in my opinion, maybe I would want to look at it more like a lump sum type deal, or also in the form of education, to say that, hey, if I graduate from UAB and get a bachelor's, if I was an athlete all that time, I should be able to come back and get as much education as I want. If I want to get a master's, mm-hmm. a doctorate, yeah. I think there's other ways to be able to pay athletes, because monetary check with extra money with some 17, 18, 19 year olds, and you having the most fun and you probably the most reckless in your life, I think we'll look back and most of them be broke in 4 years, because they'll realize, man, you know what, I ain't really do nothing with that money. I don't have anything to show for it. But hey, if I can take you through a 4-year process and make sure you're fed well and make sure you got everything you need during that process, now let's just say if I got $20,000 lump sum that I can go start me a business with, or I can go buy me some new suits to get ready to interview for jobs and some other things. Hey, now, to me, that money is sufficient, and it's a real investment, as opposed to just a couple of dollars, man, to give to the brouhaha on Saturday night. Yeah. That's just, because a lot of kids are from low-income situations. A lot of kids don't know how to balance a checkbook. A lot of them don't understand, and it took me 10 years ago, I would give you a whole nother answer, but it took me a while to step back from it and realize, okay, what would be a real investment? And I think that biggest investment could come in the form, like I say, of education and maybe even a lump sum of some sort.